This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book the Campfire Girls at School or the Wohelo Weavers by Hildegard G. Frey. Chapter 1, Chronicles in Color. Speaking of diaries, said Gladys Evans, what do you think of this for one? She spread out a bead band, about an inch and a half wide and a yard or more long, in which she had worked out in colors the main events of her summer's camping trip with the Winnebago Campfire Girls. The girls dropped their handwork and crowded around Gladys to get a better look at the band, which told so cleverly the story of their wonderful summer. "Oh, look!" cried Sawa Brewster, excitedly pointing out the figures. "There's Shadow River and the canoe floating upside down, and Ed Roberts serenading Gladys, only it turned out to be Sherry serenading Nyota, and the hike, and the 4th of July pageant, and everything." The Winnebagos were loud in their expressions of admiration, and the "Don't You Remembers" fell thick and fast as they recalled the events depicted in the bead band. It was a crisp evening in October, and the Winnebagos were having their work meeting at the Bradford House as the guests of Dorothy Bradford, or Hinpoha, as she was known in the Winnebago circle. Here were all the girls we left standing on the boat dock at Loon Lake, looking just the same as when we saw them last, a trifle less sunburned perhaps, but just as full of life and spirit. Scissors, needles, and crochet hooks flew fast as the seven girls and their guardian sat around the cheerful wood fire in the library. Sawa was tatting, Gladys and Migwon were embroidering, and Miss Kent, familiarly known as Nyota, the guardian of the Winnebago group, was mending her hole-proof hose, as she laughingly expressed it. The three more quiet girls in the circle, Nikwisi the Star Maiden, Choppa the Chipmunk, and Medmongi the Medicine Man Girl, were working out their various symbols in crochet patterns. Hinpoha was down on the floor popping corn over the glowing logs and turning over a row of apples which had been set before the fireplace to warm. The firelight streaming over her red curls made them shine like burning embers, until it seemed as if some of the fire had escaped from the grate and was playing around her face. Every few minutes she reached out her hand and dealt a gentle slap on the nose of Mr. Bob, a young cocker spaniel attached to the house of Bradford, who persistently tried to take the apples in his mouth. Nyota finally came to the rescue and diverted his attention by giving him her darning egg to chew. The room was filled with the light-hearted chatter of the girls. Sawa was relating with many giggles how she had gotten into a scrape at school. "And old Professor Fuzzytop made me bring all my books and sit up at that little table beside his desk for a week. Of course, I didn't mind that a bit, because then I could see what everybody in the room was doing instead of just the few around me. The only thing I prayed for was that Miss Muggins wouldn't come in and see me, because she has taken a sort of fancy to me and makes it easy for me in Latin, but if I ever fall from grace, she won't pass me. But of all the luck, right in the middle of the fourth hour when everybody was in the room studying, in she walked. I saw her as she opened the door, and quick as a wink, I opened up the big dictionary on the table and buried my nose in it, so she'd think I had gone up there of my own accord. She stopped and looked at me, then patted me encouragingly on the shoulder and remarked what a studious girl I was. I thought everybody in the room would die trying not to laugh, but nobody gave me away. She came in during the fourth hour for several days after that, and every time I flew to the sheltering arms of the dictionary, and she always made some approving remark out loud. Now she thinks I'm a shark, and I have a better stand-in than ever with her. She told her senior session room that there was a girl in the junior room who was so keen after knowledge that no matter when she came into the room, she always found her consulting the dictionary. Sawa's imitation of the elderly and precise Miss Muggins was so close that the girls shrieked with laughter. Even Nyota, who was a faculty and should have been the ally of the deluded instructor, was too much amused to say a word. "By the way, Sawa," she said when the laughter had died down, "how are you coming on in Latin? The last time I saw you, your Cicero had a stranglehold on you. Sawa made a fearful grimace and recited sarcastically. Not showers to larks more pleasing, not sunshine to the bee, not sleep to toil more easing than Latin prose to me. The flocks shall leave the mountains, the dew shall flee the rose, the nymphs forsake the fountains, ere I forsake my prose. Nyota laughed and shook her head at Sawa, and Miguan, otherwise Elsie Gardner, looked up at the despiser of prose composition in mild wonderment. I don't see how you can make such a fuss about learning Latin, she said. It's the least of my troubles. But I'm not such a genius as you, answered Sawa, and my head won't stand the strain. Her mental limitations did not seem to cause her any anxiety, however, for she hummed a merry tune as she drew her tatting shuttle in and out. Miguan leaned back in her chair and looked around the tastefully furnished room with quiet enjoyment. This library in the Bradford house was a never-ending delight to her. It was finished in dark oak, and the walls were hung with a rich brown paper. The floor was polished and covered with oriental rugs, whose patterns she loved to trace. At one end of the room was a big fireplace, and on each side of it a cozy seat, piled with tapestry-covered cushions. Over the fireplace hung two slender swords, the property of some departed Bradford. The handsome chairs were upholstered in brown leather to match the other furnishings, and everything in the room, from the Italian marble Psyche on its pedestal in the corner to the softly glowing lamps, gave the impression of wealth and culture. Miguan contrasted it with the shabby sitting room in her own home, and sighed. She was keenly responsive to beautiful surroundings, and would have been happy to stay forever in this library. But beautiful as the furnishings were, they were the least part of the attraction. The real drawing card were the books that filled the cases on three sides of the room. There were books of every kind: fiction, poetry, history, travel, science, and whole sets of books in handsome bindings that Miguan fairly reveled in whenever she came to visit. Hinpoha herself was not fond of reading anything but fiction, and although she had the freedom of all the cases, she never looked at anything but storybooks. Before her parents went to Europe, they had tried making her keep an average of one book of fiction to one of another kind, in the hope of instilling into her a love for essays and history, but in the absence of her father and mother, history and essays were having a long vacation, and fiction was working overtime. "Let's play something," said Sawa when the apples and popcorn had disappeared. "I'm tired of sitting still." "Can't somebody please think of a new game?" said Hinpoha. "We've played everything we know until I'm sick of it." "I thought of one the other day," said Gladys quietly. "I named it the campfire game. You play it like stagecoach or fruit basket, only instead of taking parts of a coach or names of fruits, you take articles that belong to the campfire, like bead band, ring, moccasin, bracelet, fire, honor beads, symbol, fringe, wohelo, hand sign, bow and drill, mystic fire, etc. Then somebody tells a story about campfire girls, and every time one of those articles is mentioned, everyone must get up and turn around. But if the words ceremonial meeting or council fire are mentioned, then all must change seats, and the storyteller tries to get a seat in the scramble, and the one who gets left out has to go on with the story." "Good," cried Nyota, "let's play it. You tell the story first." Gladys stood up in the center of the room and began. "Once upon a time there were a group of campfire girls called the Winnebagoes, and they went to school in the professor's big teepee on the avenue, where they pursued knowledge for all they were worth. So much wisdom did they imbibe that it was necessary to wear a headband to keep their heads from splitting open. Wherever they went, they were immediately recognized by their rings and bracelets, and were pointed out as those dreadful young savages. The professors and teachers hoped every day that they would not come to school, but they never stayed away, because they received honor beads from their guardian mother for not being absent. Sometimes it seemed as if the tricks they did in classroom could only have been accomplished by their having consulted one another, and yet it was impossible to catch them whispering in class, because they always conversed by hand signs. However, this also led to disaster one day, when one of our well-beloved sisters of the bow and drill tried to make the hand sign for a girl, and raised her hand above her head. The big chief, who was conducting the lesson, thought she wanted something, and said benevolently, "What is your desire?" Absent-mindedly, she replied, "It is my desire to become a campfire girl and obey the law of the campfire, which is to seek beauty, give service, pursue knowledge, be trustworthy, hold on to health, glorify work, and be happy." "Be gone," said the big chief. "What do you think this is, a ceremonial meeting?" At the words "ceremonial meeting," all the girls jumped up to change places, and in the scramble, a vase was knocked off the table and broken. Everyone sat rooted to the spot with fright, all except Mr. Bob, who fled at the sound of the crash as if he had been the guilty one. Hinpoha calmly collected the pieces and carried them out. "My mother will be extremely grateful to you for this when she comes home," she said. If there was one vase in the house she hated, it was this one. My Aunt Phoebe brought it from the World's Fair in Chicago and thinks it's the chief ornament of our home. Won't Mother be glad when she finds it broken, and she can prove that none of us did it?" The tension relaxed, and the girls breathed easily again. "When are your mother and father coming home?" asked Nyota. "They sailed last week on the Francona," answered Hinpoha. "Weren't you worried to death to have them in Europe so long with the war going on?" asked Miguan. "No, not much," said Hinpoha, "because they have been in Switzerland all the while, which is safe enough, and as they are coming home on a neutral vessel, they have had no trouble getting passage. They should be here in a week." And Hinpoha's eyes shone with a great, glad light, for although she had been having the jolliest time imaginable, doing as she pleased in the house, which was in the care of easygoing Aunt Grace, who never cared a bit what Hinpoha did so long as it did not bother her, she missed her mother sorely, and could hardly wait until she returned. Nyota saw the transfigured look that came into her eyes when she spoke of her mother's homecoming, and her own eyes went dim, for her mother had died when she was just Hinpoha's age. After the breaking of the vase, the game stopped, and the girls sat down again in a quiet circle. "Do you know," said Nyota, "that bead band Gladys made has given me an idea? Why can't we keep a personal record in beadwork? It would be a great deal more interesting and picturesque than keeping a diary, and there would be no danger of your little sister getting hold of it and reading your secrets out loud to her friends." "It's a great idea," said Miguan, who had always kept a diary and had suffered much from an inquisitive brother and sister. "Besides," said Sawa, "think how exciting it would be at ceremonial meetings to sit with your life story hanging around your neck and know that your neighbor was just breaking her neck trying to figure out what the little pictures meant. Wouldn't old Fuzzy Top love to be able to read mine, though?" And Sawa giggled extravagantly as she saw in her mind's eye the bead record of some of her activities in the junior session room. "Now, about all our activities," continued Nyota, "are covered by the 7 points of the campfire law, so that everything we do either fulfills or breaks the law. What do you say if we register our commendable doings in colors, but record the event in black every time we break the law?" The girls thought this would be a fascinating game, and Sawa remarked that she must send to the outfitting company for a bunch of black beads directly, as she had only a very few left. "It's a good thing we didn't keep this record last summer," said Gladys with a thoughtful look in her eyes, "or mine would have been black from one end to the other." "It wouldn't either," said Sawa vehemently. "You did more for us in the end than we ever did for you. And my sins were as scarlet as yours, every bit." Since that terrible day in camp, Gladys seemed to have been made over, and never once reverted to her old selfishness and superciliousness, so that she now had the love and esteem of every one of the Winnebagoes. All mention of her old shortcomings was quickly silenced by Sawa, who now adored her, heart and soul. Gladys's entrance into the public school after 2 years at Miss Russell's had caused quite a stir among the girls of the neighborhood, who in times past had been wont to consider her proud and haughty, but her simple, unaffected manner quickly won for her a secure place in the affections of all. Teachers and scholars alike loved her. Sawa was still counting up her own misdemeanors at camp when the Evans's automobile came for Gladys, and reluctantly all the girls prepared to go home. It always seemed harder to break away from Hinpoha's house than from any of the others. In spite of the rich furnishings, it had a cozy, homey atmosphere of being used from one end to the other, and no guest, however humble, ever felt awkward or out of place there. Thus it usually happens that when people are entirely at ease in their own surroundings, they soon make others feel the same way too. End of the chapter. Chapter 2: A Sudden Misfortune. As the day drew near for the return of her mother and father, Hinpoha went all over the house from garret to cellar, seeing that everything was put to rights. She and the other Winnebagoes took a trip into the country for bittersweet, to decorate the fireplace in the library, and in her father's study upstairs. With pardonable pride, she arranged a little exhibition of the craft work she had done in camp, and the sketches she had made of the lake and hills. On the table in her mother's room she placed a work basket she had made of reed, and lined with silk. "Gracious sakes, child," said her aunt, from her rocking chair by the front window of the living room, "what a fuss you are going to! One would think it was your Aunt Phoebe who was coming, instead of your mother and father. They'll be just as glad to see you, if the house isn't as neat as a pin from top to bottom." And Aunt Grace resumed her rocking and her novel, as unconcerned about the imminent return of the travelers as if it were nothing more than the daily visit of the milkman. Nothing short of an earthquake would ever shake Aunt Grace out of her settled complacency. Hinpoha went happily on, seeing that every tack and screw was in place, and arranging the books in the cases to correspond to her father's catalog, for they had become sadly mixed during his absence. She even took out a volume of his favorite essays and pored over them diligently so that she might discuss them with him and show that she had used some of her time to good advantage. She straightened out her bureau drawers and mended all her clothes and stockings. When everything was in order, she viewed the result with a happy feeling at the pleasure it would give her mother when she saw it. Hinpoha's most prominent trait in times past had not been neatness. Nyota, who had been called in to make a final inspection before Hinpoha was satisfied, wondered if all the girls were seeking beauty as earnestly as Hinpoha was. She envied Hinpoha the homecoming of her mother from the bottom of her heart. This feeling was particularly strong one afternoon as she sat in the schoolroom after the close of school, looking over some English papers. It was the anniversary of the death of her mother, and she sat recalling little incidents of her childhood before this best of chums had been taken away. As she sat there half-dreaming, she heard voices in the hall before her door. "Have you heard the latest?" asked one voice. "No," said the second voice. "What is it?" "Why, the Francona has gone down," answered the first voice. "Struck a mine in the ocean." At the word Francona, Nyota started up. That was the boat Hinpoha's parents were coming on. She hurried out into the hall after the two teachers. "What did you say about the Francona?" she asked. They handed her the extra they had been reading, and she saw with her own eyes the account of the disaster. The list of saved was pitifully small, and Hinpoha's parents were not among them. Soon she came to the notation, "Among the lost are Mr. and Mrs. Adam Bradford, prominent Cleveland lawyer and his wife." Mr. Bradford was the son of the late Judge Bradford, and a well-known man about town. Of what little avail is prominence when calamity stretches out her cruel hands? Well-known and obscure gave up their lives together, and found a grave side by side. "You look like a ghost, Miss Kent," said one of the teachers. "Any friends of yours on board?" "Dorothy Bradford's mother and father," answered Nyota, "one of the pupils here at school." Leaving her work unfinished, she hastened to Hinpoha's house. The news had just been learned there. Aunt Grace had fainted and was being revived with salts. Hinpoha flung herself on Nyota and clung to her like a drowning person. Between neighbors and friends coming to sympathize and reporters from the newspapers seeking interviews, the house was a pandemonium. Nyota saw that Hinpoha would never quiet down in those surroundings and took her away to her own apartment. Of all the friends who offered consolation, Nyota was the one to whom Hinpoha turned for comfort. Here the brilliant young college woman and the simple girl were on a level, for they shared a common experience and each could comprehend the other's sorrow. Poor Hinpoha. She had need of all the consolation that Nyota could give her in the days that followed. Full of bitterness as her cup was, there was to be added yet one more drop, the drop that caused it to run over. Aunt Phoebe came to live with her and be the mistress of the Bradford house. At some time in the past, Judge Bradford and his sister Phoebe had been named joint guardians of Hinpoha, but the judge was now dead, and Aunt Phoebe was the sole guardian. Aunt Phoebe was a spinster of the type usually described in books, tall and spare, with steely blue eyes. She was 60 years old, but she might have been 160, for all the sympathy she had with youth. She had been disappointed in love when she was 20, and had never thought kindly of any man since. From her earliest childhood, Hinpoha had dreaded the very name of Aunt Phoebe. When she came to visit, a restraint fell over the whole house. The usual lively chatter at the dinner table was hushed, and Aunt Phoebe held forth in solemn tones, generally berating some unfortunate person who nearly always happened to be a good friend of Mrs. Bradford's. Hinpoha would be called up for a minute examination of her clothes and manners, and would invariably do something which was not right in her great aunt's eyes. She had a vivid recollection of going tobogganing down the long front walk one winter day, her jolly mother on the sled with her, steering it adroitly around the corner and up the sidewalk for a distance after leaving the slope. Such fun they were having that they did not look to see if the road was clear, and went bumping into a female figure that was coming majestically along the street, knocking her off her feet and into a snowdrift. It was Aunt Phoebe, coming to make a formal afternoon call. She sat bolt upright in the snow and adjusted her lorgnette to see if by any chance her grandniece could be one of those rowdy children. When she discovered that it was not only Hinpoha, but her mother as well, frolicking so indecorously, she was speechless. Mrs. Bradford started to make an abject apology, but the sight of Aunt Phoebe sitting in the snowdrift with her lorgnette was too much for her, and she went off into a peal of laughter in which Hinpoha joined gleefully. It was weeks before Aunt Phoebe could be coaxed to make another visit. And this was the woman who was coming to take the place of Hinpoha's beloved mother. Aunt Grace left the day she came. There was not enough room in one house for her and Aunt Phoebe. With Aunt Phoebe came Silky, a wiggling, snapping Skye terrier. He gave one glance at genial Mr. Bob, who was rolling on his back before the fireplace, and with a growl, fastened his teeth into his neck. Hinpoha rescued her pet and bore him away to her room, where she shed tears of despair while he licked her hand sympathetically. Aunt Phoebe's first act was to put Hinpoha into deep mourning. Hinpoha objected strenuously, but there was no help, and she went to school swathed from head to foot in black. Nyota was wrathful at the sight, for if there was one point she felt strongly about it, was putting children into mourning. Among the gaily dressed girls, Hinpoha stood out like some dark spirit from the underworld, casting a gloom wherever she went. "Where is that beautiful vase I brought your mother from the World's Fair?" asked Aunt Phoebe one day, suddenly missing it. "It was accidentally broken at our last campfire meeting," answered Hinpoha, with a tightening around her heart when she thought of that last happy gathering. "Campfire," said Aunt Phoebe with a snort. "You don't mean to tell me that you are mixed up in any such foolishness as that?" "I certainly am," said Hinpoha energetically, and it isn't foolishness either. I've learned more since I have been a campfire girl than I did in all the years before. Well, you may consider yourself graduated then, said Aunt Phoebe dryly, for I'll have no such nonsense about me. I can teach you all you need to know outside of what you learn in school. Campfire always had Mother's fullest approval, said Hinpoha darkly. I dare say, returned her aunt. But I want you to understand once for all that I won't have any girls holding meetings here to upset the house and break valuable ornaments. But you don't care if I go to them at other girls' houses, do you? Asked Hinpoha, the fear gripping her that she was to be denied the consolation of these weekly gatherings with the Winnebagoes. I don't want you to have anything to do with that campfire business, said Aunt Phoebe in a tone of finality, and Hinpoha left the room, her heart swelling with bitterness. She was too wise to argue the point with Aunt Phoebe, and resolved to depend on Nyota to show her the way. She dried her tears and went down to the living room and began to play softly on the piano. It had been her mother's piano, the wedding gift of her father, and it seemed that her mother's spirit hovered over it. It was the first time she had touched the keys since that awful Wednesday when the world had been turned into chaos. She had had no heart to play, but today, the sound of the music comforted her, and her bitter resentment against her aunt lost some of its sting. She played on, lost in memories, when suddenly the sharp voice of her aunt brought her back to earth. "What does this mean?" cried Aunt Phoebe, playing on the piano when your father and mother have just died. I never heard of such a thing. Come away immediately, and don't open that piano again until our period of mourning is over. She closed the piano and locked it, putting the key into her bag. Under Aunt Phoebe's management, the house soon lost its look of inviting friendliness. The blinds were always kept drawn, so that even on the brightest days the rooms had a gloomy appearance. No more cheerful wood fires crackled and glowed in the grate. They made ashes on the rugs and were extravagant, as the house was heated by steam. The bookcases were locked, and Hinpoha was forbidden to read fiction, as this was not proper when one was in mourning. You will become acquainted with much pleasant literature reading to me while I crochet, she said, when Hinpoha rose in revolt at this edict. The pleasant literature which Aunt Phoebe was just then perusing was a history of the Presbyterian Church in 11 volumes, which bored Hinpoha so it nearly gagged her. Besides, Aunt Phoebe constantly found fault with Hinpoha's manner of reading. It was either too loud or not loud enough, either too fast or too slow, but it was never right. That reading aloud was the last straw to Hinpoha. After sitting still a whole afternoon getting her school lessons, she longed to move about after supper. But then Aunt Phoebe expected her to sit still the entire evening and entertain her with the activities of the early presbytery. After nearly a week of this deadly dullness, Hinpoha was ready to fly. And yet Aunt Phoebe was not conscious that there was anything wrong in the way she was treating Hinpoha. She cared for her in her frozen way. She was merely trying to bring her up in the way she herself had been brought up by a maiden aunt, not taking into account that this was another day and age. In her time, it was considered the proper thing to shut down on all lightheartedness after a death in the family, and she was adhering steadfastly to the old principles. She was yet to learn that she could not force obsolete customs upon a girl who had lived for 16 years in the sunlight of modern ideas. All Hinpoha's troubles were confided to Nyota, who sympathized with her entirely, but bade her be of good cheer and hope for the time when Aunt Phoebe would see for herself that the new way was best, and above all, to win the respect and liking of her aunt the first thing, as more could be accomplished in this way than by being antagonistic. I don't suppose you could go for a long walk with me Sunday afternoon? Said Nyota. Hinpoha shook her head sadly. We don't do anything like that on Sunday, she answered, with resentment flaming in her eye. We go to church morning and evening, and in the afternoon I am supposed to read the Bible or a book by a man named Thomas A. Kempis. Nyota turned her eyes inward with such a comical expression that Hinpoha forgot her troubles for a moment and laughed.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.